Easter. What difference does it make? I want to suggest that it makes all the difference in the world. I don't know if you've noticed, but this last couple of weeks there's been a movie at the theater called The Case for Christ. Anybody seen that? Anybody? Got a couple people that have seen the movie The Case for Christ? It's the story of an investigative reporter. His name is Lee Strobel, and he's an atheist. His wife is an atheist. And they had a crisis life and death experience that makes his wife start to think about God. She winds up meeting a Christian, and ultimately comes to faith in Christ. That really upsets Lee Strobel. He is really not very tolerant, and it causes marriage problems, it causes a collision. He is an investigative reporter, and he is determined, and he sets out to disprove the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And as being a Chicago Tribune investigative reporter, he's very good. He's all about the evidence, and he's all about the facts, and he does a pursuit. He is going to every authority that there is, from a psychological analysis about Christ and his followers. He goes to the leading psychologist of the day. For a medical purpose, did he really actually die? He goes to the leading authority on the death by a cross. He goes to all these people, and the evidence is just overwhelmingly for the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. And he still does not want to believe it. I'm not going to spoil the whole movie. You got to see it for yourself. If you don't go to the theater to see it, it'll be out on Netflix. It'll be out on, it'll come out. But you want to see this movie. I just want to suggest this. Before there was Lee Strobel, okay, there was a guy by the name of Saul of Tarsus. And he hated this sect called the Way. You see, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so they called his followers the people of the Way, and he hated that sect. And he was out to, not just to disprove it, but to destroy them. And this guy by the name of Saul, when the very first martyr, Stephen, was being martyred, he was there with him, consenting unto Stephen's death. He became a person who went out to round up Christians and incarcerate them, and he persecuted them. And later, when he has his own personal encounter with Jesus Christ, his name is changed from Saul to Paul. Jesus met him on the road to Damascus when he was trying to round up Christians, and when he met him, he says, the first thing that Saul says when Jesus appears in his bright light to him, he says, who are you, Lord? He called him Lord. He knew that he had run into somebody bigger than himself. And he said, I am Jesus. I am Jesus. The fact that Jesus rose from the dead changed everything for the Apostle Paul. Everything. Lee Strobel changed everything when he encountered the historical Lord Jesus Christ through the Holy Scriptures. Today I want to focus on what difference does it make? And the first thing I want to say, it makes a powerful difference. It makes a powerful difference. We're going to take the Apostle Paul's words here. He was against Christ. He wanted to destroy his followers. But meeting Jesus, he does this. He says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. Do you notice it doesn't say, I want to know about Christ? A lot of people know about him. It's kind of like I know a lot about Donald Trump. He's a billionaire. He's president. He's got really good kids. He's got a foul mouth sometimes. Yeah, I mean, I'd go on and on, right? Well, I'll tell you right now, I don't know Donald Trump. You know what I'm saying? If I were to make a phone call to the White House, say, hey, it's Dennis, he'd say, Dennis who? Because he doesn't know me either, all right? Paul says, listen, I don't want to know about Jesus. I want to know Jesus. You see, he's more than some facts. He's a person who is alive. He arose from the dead. He's ascended into heaven. And I can still have a personal relationship with Jesus, just like the Apostle Paul. He was risen and ascended into heaven, and Paul had a personal relationship with Jesus. And he says, I want to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection. He has such power that he said, you take my life and I will raise it up again. I lay my life down and I will take it up again. He has the power to give life. Paul goes a little bit further here and he says, and I'd like to know the fellowship of sharing in his suffering. He said, I will suffer for Jesus. Well, before he inflicted suffering, he says, listen now, Jesus changed everything in my life. I'll suffer for Jesus. Here I am. I'll volunteer for that. Becoming like him in his death, I will sacrifice my life for Jesus just as Jesus sacrificed his life for me. This is a radical change. The resurrection made all the difference in the world. He says, so that somehow I might attain to the resurrection from the dead. I too want to be resurrected. Should I die? Should I die? The second thing I notice about this passage is that the Apostle Paul said, when it comes to the difference that the resurrection makes, Easter makes, it makes a purposeful difference. Notice what the text says. Not that I've already obtained all this. I have not yet fully arrived or have already been made perfect. You see, I'm not there yet. I'm not perfect. The day is coming when I will be, but it's not right now. He says, but instead, right now, this is what I do. I press to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. He said, listen, Jesus created me and Jesus rescued me. He crashed into my life and into my experience to give me a purpose for living. He has a purpose for every single one of us here. A lot of people are wandering through life a little aimless. You know, it's kind of like the archer who pulls the bow back and he shoots it and it hits the wall and then he goes and gets a can of spray paint and paints a target around it. Got a bullseye, right? Because you're really aiming at nothing. You don't know what you're doing in life, where you're going. He says, listen, Jesus grabbed hold of me. He took hold of my life. So that I would have purpose, I would have direction, I would know where I am going, I would have a purpose to fulfill. That I just don't go through life aimlessly and hope when I'm all done that I've hit the target. And if I haven't, I'll just paint my own around it and say, yeah, I did. He said, Easter makes a purposeful difference. It also makes a perspective difference. Brothers, I do not consider myself to have taken hold of it. He said, listen, I'm not there yet. I haven't fulfilled the purpose for which God has for me. For the day in which I fulfill the purpose God has for me, he takes me home. And he says, but one thing I do, this is what I'm doing. He says, I forget what's behind. Some of us live in the past. You ever said, well, you know, in the good old days, okay? The good old days, or the glory days, or those years behind. Do you remember when? And the Apostle Paul says, I deliberately forget what's past. Well, sure enough, you know, if I'd had his record too, you know, I've been out persecuting the church, I've been consenting to people's deaths, and I had been, you know, there were pretty terrible things. But he doesn't just keep it there. Not just the bad things. He says, I'm letting go of the good things I've done too. I don't want to live in the past. You know, you don't have to live in your past. And you don't have to allow your past to control your life now. Jesus is in the business of giving you a new perspective so that you can forget what's behind. And the further it gets in the past, the smaller it gets. That's the way perspective works. When something is further away, the tinier it becomes until it's gone. And there are things in all of our lives we wish we could forget. And he's saying, listen, I'm forgetting. I'm letting go. I'm going to let go of those things, and I'm going to put them in my rearview mirror, and I'm not going to look at the rearview mirror. Instead, he says, Easter makes a present difference. He says, now that I know Jesus and I have a new purpose in my life, I am straining. It's like he's in a metaphor of a race. And he's the runner, and he says, I am straining. I'm putting all my energy into right now, in time, where I'm at, in the immediate, the now. I'm straining ahead towards the future. He says, I've got new goals. New goals. He goes on, he says, I press on towards the goal. And the goal, he says, I want to cross that finish line. And crossing that finish line, I want to hear the Lord say, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a little. Come and enjoy your reward in the kingdom. He said, listen, I'm not looking at the past. I'm straining in the present. You know, some of the time when you're pressing, you know, you're pressing towards that finish line, you get a little distractive. Can you imagine being a hurdler? And you're running in the race. You're a high school hurdler. Go back in time just a little bit. And, you know, back when you had energy and you could go over the hurdles, right? And you're running, and as you're going over the hurdles, okay, your girlfriend or your boyfriend in the stands yells, go, go, go. And you turn your head with a big smile because they're so impressed with your running. And your knee hits that thing, you go down into the ground. Why? You took your eyes off the goal. You took your eyes off the goal. You get distracted. You go to one side or the other and you find yourself in big trouble. You lose the race. He says, I press towards the goal. I'm fixed on Jesus. And he said, I want to cross that finish line. He says, so that I might win. I want to win. I want to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. I want to be able to cross that line and hear him say, well done. Good job, Dan. Well done. Good job. Put your name in there. I want to win the prize. I would guarantee that there's no one that got up this morning and said, you know what? I think today I'd like to be a loser. Anybody? Didn't think so. You know, we wake up and we say, I'd love to be a winner today. I want to be a winner. I want to be a winner. There's two things I want to leave with you on about winning, two thoughts on winning, okay? And the first thought comes from a guy by the name of Stephen Bradbury. Some of you might remember him. He was in the 2002 Winter Olympics. He was a speed skater, and he was from the country of Australia, which is not known for having good winters of a lot of ice and snow. And so, in fact, in the Southern Hemisphere had never had a gold medal winner, okay, in ice skating in the Olympics ever from the south of the equator. It's just not their sports, okay? And so he's not the best speed skater in the world. And the thing I like about this guy is that he said, I'm going to enter the race anyway. And he goes and he represents the country of Australia, and he's in the final round. And there's three other skaters that he's competing with in the 1,000-meter skating, and they're all champions, okay? They're all from the Northern Hemisphere, and they've already got medals under their belts, and they're like the best, and he doesn't. And he's in the skating, he's skating his hardest, and he's in last place. I mean, there's a big gap between him and the other three. They're all clustered together, and they're jockeying for position when the guy in the front fell down, bumping the other guy, topples all of them. And Stephen Bradbury just cruises across the finish line. He wins the gold medal in the 1,000-meter speed racing ice competition. He had never dreamed of such a thing. Here's my point. First point I want you to get. To win, you got to be in the race. You've got to be in the race. If you want to be a winner and hear God say, well done, good and faithful servant, you've got to be in the race. How do you get in the race? Paul told us. You have to know Jesus. And you've got to know the power of his resurrection. Not know about him, but to really know him personally. You've got to have, as John said, believe in him, receive him to become a child of God. You receive him. The word is welcome him into your life. John said he knocks at the door. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. You receive him. When you believe in him, you've entered the race. You're in the race. That's a starting point. You got to be in the race if you want to win. The next thought that I have, the second thought, comes from my teenage years, okay? When I was a teenager, I liked antique automobiles. Maybe there's a few others here who like antique automobiles, okay? I liked antique automobiles. And I saved up my paper route money, and when I was 15 years old, I bought a 1932 Willys Overland. It looks a little bit better there than when I first bought it. There was no roof in it because it had little strips of wood across and it had a canvas top on it. Well, in between that was chicken wire. And so my dad, and he helped me do some of the stuff on the body. And I had a younger brother. He helped me a lot on it. My little brother, David, he helped a lot. We did everything together. So, and he helped me a lot on that car. This was a great car. I'm going to brag about my car for a few minutes, okay? I just want to tell you about it. It had a whopping 65 horsepower. Okay? You run the engine for about 3 minutes, oil pressure dropped to zero. It was a three-speed with overdrive on the dash. Another lever. In 1932, it won the Pike, not my car, but the car that was entered into the race. It won the Pikes Peak mountain climb competition between all the cars, internationally. So it's a good car. I love this car. You notice it has air conditioning? On the cowl, that's the part just outside the windshield there, the cowl. You push this little lever and up pops a vent and air blows in down on your legs, okay? And if you really want to help it, you took a little, and you cranked and the windshield kind of tilted out. And as you're driving, the wind would come in over your face, on your legs. It wasn't such a treat in the wintertime. It didn't have a heater. I called it Armstrong heater with my girlfriend. You're getting the picture. This is an old car, okay? Now, I didn't buy this brand new. You know, this car was already 35 years old, all right? And I had problems with it every now and then. My dad and I, we'd work on it, and I tool around in it. The beautiful part is the starter kept going out on it. You say, that's terrible. Yeah, it was kind of terrible. But under the front seat, I could lift it up. It was like a little trunk in the inside. I kept my crank, and I'd get the crank bar, go out into the front, stick it through the grill, and I'd impress all the ladies. One pull, my car would start. Crank start. It was awesome. I drove it through high school. It was just a wonderful. And I got this great idea, and I said to my younger brother, David, I said, hey, Dave, what do you think if we take my car to the Detroit Dragway and race it? He said, sure, I'm in. And so I said, okay, you can be my pit crew. So the two of us. I didn't invite anybody else because, come on, Detroit Dragway. It's a stock six, only 65 horsepower. Top speed I ever had it was 50. Are you kidding me? So we tool down. We have to stop a couple times because it overheats and we're putting water in. We're tinkering with it. Just in case I needed to start, he could push or he could crank, you know. And so we go down to the Detroit Dragway. When I get to the Detroit Dragway, I'm ready to go. Have you ever been to Dragway? You know how this works. You pull up to the Christmas tree. That's what we called it, okay? It's the starting block. You can't go across the line, okay? You got to just pull up to the line. And I pull up to the line, and it's sitting red. When it's time to go, it begins to change colors. Yellow, yellow, yellow. green, and when it hits green, you hit it, man. You punch it, and you take off as fast as you can. And so when it hit green, I punched it as hard as I could, and the guy next to me did too. There it was, laying next to me, a 1969 AMX. It was sponsored by the American Motors Corporation. This thing had big, huge tires on the back. They put something on the tires. It did a burnout. Smoke was everywhere. And he did a wheelie coming up to the line. And I'm looking over at him. When that light hit green, I punched it as hard as I could. He punched it. Now, I got to tell you something. That AMX was less than 10-second car, man. It was down that track. In less than 10 seconds, it was done. There I was in my 32 Willys. It took me 28 seconds and 38 hundredths of a second. Almost three times as long. I'm driving, and even though I got my windows up and they're all closed because I didn't want any wind resistance, I could hear the announcer saying, Al Capone is already gone. Here comes Elliot Ness after him. He's humiliating me. It's bad enough this guy blows my doors off, you know, and this guy, he's mocking me while I'm going, all right? So, my 32 Willys, 28, 38 seconds. Wow. I just wanted to add one more feature to the whole story. I won. Whoa! I won! Look at that, I got the trophy. Listen, hey, hold on. I brought it, see, this is living proof. Living proof. I won. I won. You say, how does that? Did he jump too soon? Nope, didn't jump too soon. What is, engine blow up on the way down, didn't finish? No, he crossed the finish line. Well, did he disqualify himself somehow? No. How in the world did you win? Well, it's really simple. I was in a class all by myself. He was in a class all by himself. They wanted to save time, so they ran us both at the same time. He was competing against no one but himself. I was competing against no one but myself. All I had to do was not jump early and then cross the finish line. I say that because every single person here is in a class all their self. You're in a class all yourself. God is not expecting from you what he expects from me, and he's not expecting from me what he expects from you. He laid his hand on me for a purpose, and I'm in a class all my own, and I want to cross that finish line. I want to cross that finish line. You're in a class all your own, and you're in the race, and you need to cross that finish line to be the winner. To be the winner. He said, first of all, you got to be in the race. My second thought is this: God wants you to be a winner. God wants you to be a winner. This is so important. He didn't create you to curse you. The Bible says when he created man, he blessed them. He wants to bless you. God wants you to be a winner. Now, as I go down a little bit further in this passage, the race is actually a team effort. It's a team effort. I had my pit crew. There's my younger brother, Dave. My younger brother, Dave, was only 14 at the time. He was just having a great time with me, you know, and we did just about everything together. I noticed a little bit further in verse 17, we looked at verses 13 and 14. Verse 17 in Philippians, it says, join with others in following my example. This is a team effort. That's why we're the church. We get together. We're all on the same team. We're all on the same team. The goal for all of us is to glorify Jesus Christ and hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. I'm not accountable for him. My brother was the mechanic, man. He grew up to be a body repair man. I always took my car to him for fixing. I never fixed my car. You see, God called him to do that. He called me to do what I do, and we're on the same team. You know, when the car went across that finish line, he as much invested in that trophy as I did. He says, hallelujah, we won, we won, we won. It's kind of like if the Lions will ever win a Super Bowl, I'll say, we won. We won. And I never played on the field ever. Why? That's not my job. My job. You see, I was called to be the spectator in the stand to cheer the team on. The church are those people who believe and all have the same goal, that I want to cross the finish line. My brother Dave, almost a year ago, 10 months ago, it'll be 2 months from this week, that my brother died. He crossed the finish line before I did. He's heard before I did. Well done, good and faithful servant, David, because you've laid up so much treasure in this life. Wait till you see what you got here in heaven. Great is your reward. Great is your joy in heaven. Last thing I want to point out here is Easter. It makes a winning difference, but it makes a lasting difference. Our citizenship is in heaven. In heaven. Bethany represents a team in the race of life whose home is heaven. My brother Dave was a part of the church, the body of Christ. He represented the team, which is heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under control will transform our lowly bodies so they will be like his glorious body. You know what this is saying? Absent from the bodies, present with the Lord. When the Lord returns at the resurrection, he's bringing all those who are with Jesus now, and he's resurrecting their body. And when they get that resurrection body, it's going to be one just like Jesus. Never, ever to die again. And he takes us to be in heaven and with him forever and ever and ever. I like that prospect of winning. How about you? Amen? I like that prospect of winning. To do that, you got to be in the race. You have to know him. Not about him. You have to know him. What difference does Easter make? It makes believers into winners. Into winners. And you can become a winner right now. It's so simple. You just believe today. You say, Lord, I want you to be my Lord and Savior. I believe. I believe. I trust you. I'm entering the race. I don't want to just know about you. I want to know you. I want to know your power. I want to know you. You do that, he'll put you in the race. He'll be the captain of your team. He'll be the goal. And when you cross the finish line, he's going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Father in heaven, there's someone here today who perhaps has never placed their faith in Jesus and said, I want to receive you as my Lord and Savior. We pray that today, right now, in this moment, they'll say, Lord, I believe. I want to receive you. Be my Savior. Lord, you will. You'll save that person in this very moment. And you'll put them on the winning team. Lord, we're so very thankful for your word, what it teaches, how it instructs us. I pray, Lord, that there's someone here who's, they've been in the race, but they've got sidetracked, but somebody in the stands calling their name, something in the world or something in family, and they've lost focus of the goal, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, and they just need to get back in the race. Right now, Lord, I just pray that they would say to you, Lord, I'm coming back, I'm coming home. I'm getting back in the race. I'm going to live for you. I'm going to put things in perspective. I'm going to put the past in the past. I'm going to forget what's behind. I'm going to focus on you today. I'm going to live for you. Lord, we know that you will hear those prayers. Whether it is to get in the race or just get back into the race, you will hear it. You will hear that prayer, and then you will, with your spirit, you'll give promptings, coaching, and how to run the race and complete it to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Bless us on this Easter morning with the realization that we are winners because of Easter. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. I got a final thought. This was a baptism today representing death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus and our identification with him. And we have two baptism candidates who were baptized. And we want to officially extend the right hand of fellowship into membership of Bethany Church. And I have both a baptism certificate and a membership certificate to give to them. And we're going to do that this time. And then the deacons are going to come and extend a right hand of fellowship to them. And after that, we invite the whole church to come and shake their hand and say, welcome to the family of Bethany. God bless you, Chloe. God bless you, Carissa. And I also want to say that Connie, Stephen, and Michael Croft are reinstating their membership here at Bethany Church today as well. They've been members in the past, and they've come back to us, and they're members again. And we want to just say this, that the council unanimously, along with the deacons, unanimously welcoming them back. So you extend the right hand of fellowship back to them as well today. God bless you. Have a wonderful Resurrection Sunday, because the Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. And there is no council meeting this Tuesday evening. Last announcement. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.